Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2023. Alec Riley has given his apologies for this meeting and I will welcome Jackie Bailey, who is attending as his substitute. Good morning, Jackie. This morning we will continue our inquiry into the NHS recovery of dental services, and I would like to welcome to the meeting David McCall, who is Chair of the British Dental Association Scottish Dental Practice Committee, Douglas Thane, Chair of the Scottish Dental Association, and Dr Atif Bashir, my apologies, Chair of the Scottish Dental Practice Owners. Thank you for giving up your time to join us this morning, gentlemen, and thank you for your written submissions. We estimate this session will run up to 10:30 a.m. and each member will have approximately 10 or 11 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions. I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak, so I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interests of brevity. So I will now turn to questions and I will hand over to Murdo Fraser, our Deputy Convener.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, gentlemen. Thank you for joining us. Can I maybe just start off and ask you just to say very briefly who you are and perhaps explain to me what the difference is between the British Dental Association, Scottish Dental Practice Committee and the Scottish Dental Association?
So I'll speak about the Scottish Dental Practice Owners Group. So we represent the practice owners that deliver the service of NHS dentistry to the people of Scotland. Hmm. So the practices.
Okay.
Okay. The facilities through which the delivery of the NHS is happening to the Scottish people. So the BDA represents, so we don't, in the Scottish Dental Practice Owners Group, the only criterion to be a member is that you need to be a practice owner. Now, you may be a dentist, you may not be a dentist, you may be a nurse or a therapist, but you have to be a practice owner. Okay, so David, would you like to explain the BDA?
Yeah, I'll give you my background. Is I've been working in Govan Hill in Glasgow in an NHS practice for, this is my 37th year. I'm a member of the BDA. The BDA has a committee called the Scottish Dental Practice Committee that is an elected committee from all of the areas in Scotland, and we represent all non-salaried general dental practitioners. And the Scottish Government have a legal obligation to negotiate on items pertaining to the funding of NHS dentistry with the Scottish Dental Practice Committee.
Okay, thank you.
My background, I'm a dentist working in Cumbernauld. I've been a practice owner there for just over 20 years. Scottish Dental Association was born out of the pandemic. Basically, dentists are not BDA members for various reasons. We thought there was a gap in the market to represent their interests. So we've spent the last few years creating the SDA. We're a work in progress. We have 800-900 members at the moment, but we're early days for us.
Right. So you're not splitters.
No.
I'm just trying to work out what the relationship is between all three of you.
I think it's a situation where dentists have been quite apolitical and disinterested in the politics of it until the crunch came, and now maybe there's scope for us all to band together at some stage. But yeah, we're kind of forward-looking rather than a splinter.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Can I just also add, actually, you know, so just again for your information, there, not every dentist or dental care professional in Scotland is a member of the BDA. Hmm. Right? You know, so we're trying to, I mean, the pandemic was difficult for everybody. Do you know, and what we're trying to do is to best represent ourselves so we can best support the people of Scotland moving forward.
Okay. Thanks. I just want to understand where everybody was, so that's been very helpful. If we can move on to the substance of the inquiry, we're really interested in looking at the impact COVID has had on dental services across Scotland. And I was reading the submission from the BDA, so I'll ask yourself, Mr. McCall, this question first of all. You have a very striking statistic in that, where you say dentistry has lost over half, 52% of its capacity since lockdown. So I suppose my first question, therefore, is how long is it going to take us to get back to where we were, if ever, and what needs to happen to ensure that we do?
There's so many facets to answering that.
Yeah.
I mean, it really hinges on reform. That's where we need. Pre-COVID, the system of delivery was unfit for purpose. And if COVID showed anything, that the current system we have was broken. What we need is proper root and branch reform. We need to move away from an item of service delivery model because it's not fit for 2023 healthcare delivery. That's where we need to be. We have a real recruitment and retention problem because the NHS is not being seen as an attractive place to work. We cannot recruit dentists, let alone any other staff, to work in NHS practices.
Sorry, just interrupt for a second. Are you talking specifically about NHS practice?
Yes.
As opposed to private practice?
Yes.
So there's not a recruitment issue in private practice?
No.
Okay.
Absolutely not. Okay. No, we have spoken to students now who know, even going through university, they do not want to work in the NHS. So the reform we are looking for is not just payment reform. It has to be holistic, complete root and branch reform because we need to attract people to work in the NHS as a career.
Okay, happy to. I mean, don't feel you have to repeat what other people say, but if you've anything you want to add, please come in.
Yeah, Mr. Fain. I think the kind of split between NHS and private practice is it's an infinitely variable split. Our practice is very largely NHS based. All patients are NHS registered, and 80-odd% of the treatment we do is NHS. Other practices can have fully NHS registered patients who opt for the majority of their treatment to be done on a private basis. Other practices will have some NHS patients and some fully private patients. And the recruitment issue is most acute in the more NHS end of the spectrum, where I mean, we've lost two associates to fully private practices over these last 2 years. And there's nothing you can say to a young dentist who wants to work in a private practice, seeing 10, 15 patients a day for a sensible level of remuneration. Please stay and see 40 patients a day in this crazy treadmill because it's better for you. It's just not. And until that situation changes and people want to work in our practice, as they have done for the last 20 years, the recruitment issue within the NHS end of the spectrum is going to remain as bad as it is, if not worse.
Just before Dr. Bashir, you come in, can I just follow something up? Because so you've raised some really interesting points. I suppose from our committee's point of view, what we're looking at specifically is the impact of COVID. So what I'm interested in is, to what extent has this happened because of COVID, or was this happening anyway?
I think it was, I mean, I found 2018, 2019, the NHS was becoming about as much as I could tolerate, but there was no real change in sight. So there was no body of dentists that I thought seemed interested in pushing for reform. COVID gave everyone a chance to reflect, and it was the early stages of COVID when there was a kind of brief panic across the profession that no one really knew if we were going to be supported, how things were going to pan out. You know, we closed our practice up in March 2020. The health board wanted to use the practice as a COVID hub for COVID positive patients, and we had no idea where we were going from there. So, you know, social media took over, and before we knew it, hundreds, thousands of dentists were crying out for some kind of body to support them and some kind of leadership. And that was really where the problem came from. And there was initially a real drive to get reform in the NHS, and other more practical minded people realised that moving towards a more private way of operating was the way to go. And going from almost zero activity to rebooting the service, the private side for a lot of people was just taken off from there as a way to serve patients and as a way to make their own lives better in a way that they probably hadn't previously had the chance to do. So, I think it's, again, as David said, there's been an unhappiness for a long time with, I don't think anyone thought there was a chance to change things. COVID gave us that chance. There was a brief hope that reform could happen. We seem to have lost that window now. We're back on the treadmill and stopping everything again for a second time, moving to a third system in the space of as many years, isn't going to be easy for anyone, and so many people have jumped ship, and they're going to be very difficult to persuade to get back on board.
Okay. Dr. Bashir. Yeah.
So the question was, how has the pandemic affected our NHS recovery? So here's the thing, is that I think what we need to understand is that we are serving to the Scottish people. Dentists in Scotland are delivering a low fee. That's not the important bit. The bit that's important is the high volume. And the other part that's important is the disease-centred model. So we're delivering this high volume, low fee, disease-centred model to the Scottish public. This is the vehicle through which we are operating. Now, so patients going in, the Scottish people going into the pandemic, into lockdown, they weren't dentally fit enough as a consequence of that delivery model that we were utilising. Now, then the pandemic happens. We have lockdown for 2 years. Then we have this, which then results in a bigger backlog. But then what we do is we then, instead of changing what we do, we just go back to using that same model to try and fix the backlog, this high volume disease-centred model, which is a very, very dated model. You know, and as Doug has said, that we've been working on this high volume treadmill for many, many years. And the thing is, it's stressful for dentists, okay, and it's stressful for the support staff. But actually, that's not the important thing. The important thing is that it actually traumatizes the patients. Because patients don't get, if you're delivering high volume dentistry, you know, which is invasive, it creates anxiety to the people of Scotland. What are you doing to them? You're traumatizing them, right? So now we have lockdown. Lockdown happens. People were anxious about going to the dentist before lockdown. Then they can't go for 2 years and they start to worry, right? You know, I haven't been for 2 years. I've got all these problems that are happening. My teeth are breaking, etc. And then that gives them even more anxiety. Right? And then they can't get an appointment to see the dentist. Some people just don't, they just step away. So they don't access the service at all. So we're seeing that more. But some people try and access the service and then they can't access the service, which I think is really bad. So it's really bad for the Scottish people. And what we need to do, so the backlog is related to the delivery that we were, so the size of the backlog is related to the type of delivery that we were doing. So in terms of coming back out of this now, it's going to take more than 2 years to get rid of the backlog. The practices that have more NHS commitment or more NHS patients, it's going to be more difficult for them, wrongly so, right, than the ones that have private patients. And that, for me, is not a good situation for the people of Scotland.
Lots more questions, but specifically, just on your last point, Dr. Bashir, I think you said it would take more than 2 years to get out of the backlog. I mean, I'm interested to get David and Douglas's perspective on that, because I think you were taking a much more pessimistic view in terms of whether we'd get out of the backlog at all.
Well, I think, Murdo, what I would say about the backlog is that the patients we're currently seeing are high treatment need. They're not people who just come in and it's just a couple of visits. This is going to take a long, long time to see them. We're probably all the same. I mean, the first checkup appointment will probably be about 3 months away. But it's okay seeing someone for a checkup. You need to point them for treatment. So we need to work flexibly. And the current system we're working in does not allow us to work flexibly. And it doesn't allow us to skill mix within the practice. Not everyone needs to see a dentist. So we have therapists and hygienists and trained DCPs that could be doing some of that work. But the system we're working in does not allow us to do that. So we need significant reform to try and get through that.
So finally, without reform, will we clear the backlog?
No.
Okay. And that would be your view of all of this?
That's the situation. If we see a patient, as I saw a 14-year-old girl yesterday, is a new patient, which is quite rare to have space to see a new patient. She needs a couple of fillings done. That's going to be 4 months away for the next available appointment, and probably another couple of months for the next appointment following that. So the time we spend doing her exam will be remunerated for that when the course of treatment is completed 5 or 6 months from now. Her situation, unfortunately, is going to get worse over these intervening months. So then the treatment may well end up being more complex. So again, it's even longer before we see any remuneration for work we've done. And it's going right back to when the multiplier on treatment was at 1.7. We'd started doing treatment, been offered this much, and by the time the course of treatment is completed, the multipliers dropped down to 1.1. So we're actually being paid less than we originally thought we were being paid. And there's that big window where we've committed the time, the manpower, the materials, and received nothing in compensation whatsoever. Also, while that's happening, patients have not been seen for 3 years. The registration fee drops off from £1.20 a month to 12 pence a month or thereabouts. So the continuing care payments, which make up about half of the practice's income, have dropped off a cliff. That drop was suspended for the first couple of years during COVID. It's now active again. And I mean, one of our associates who's off on maternity leave, her income from that has more than halved since she put off maternity. So again, that's a baseline figure on which the practice allowance is calculated. So it's just like a compound loss of income while still working hard, actually treating more anxious patients with greater needs for less return. And always the more you do it, the worse off you get. It's an impossible situation. In terms of recovering the backlog, it's just never going to happen while this situation.
Okay, gentlemen, I'm sorry. I'm really conscious of time. Murdoch, I'm going to move on. And Jackie, if you'd like to pick up where we were on staffing, please.
Thank you very much. I'm going to pursue some of the issues that Murdo started off with you, but relating specifically to staffing. Douglas Thame, you said you referred to the treadmill in reference to NHS dentistry. Can you unpack that a little so that people understand?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's probably touched on there a bit. It's a case of we're working at a pace and you simply can't slow down. We've got lots of patients with needs and they have to be seen within a realistic time frame. And while we're busy doing this, it's impossible to kind of step aside, reform, do something better. But an example, tomorrow I'll be getting into the practice just to see patients with toothache, and the bulk of them are going to be patients who have not been in the practice in the last 3 or 4 years, which means we've had a monthly commitment of 12 pence from them for the registration. I'll be taking teeth out for £16 a tooth. We'll be taking the pulps out of teeth to start root treatments, again, for which no fees payable until the course of treatment is completed months down the line. And that's taking care of a very small percentage of our 20,000 patients who haven't seen us for a long time. We're also doing that with fewer dentists than before because the smart ones have jumped ship. They don't have the obligation that the practice owners are left with. And for a young dentist getting into that, before they know it, they're in a similar situation, which is very akin to treadmill. You slow down, you fall off the back, and it's hard to get back on again.
That's helpful, thank you. Can I ask David McCall, the BDA did a survey that suggested that 59% of dentists have reduced their NHS commitment, and that's likely to increase, and 34% are either retiring or leaving to start a new career. Can you kind of just rehearse for us why people are leaving, why they're reducing their NHS commitments?
Jackie, they're just not seeing the NHS as an attractive place to work. That's the big problem. When we talk to students, and I mean, students tell me that they don't want to work in the NHS, that's really disturbing, because we need an NHS dental service to survive. Scottish Government supported NHS dental practices really well during COVID, but we need to move on from that. That support needs to continue. And it's not just about payment reform, as I said. You need to make the NHS an attractive place to work. Private practice is a very attractive place to work because you can set your own fees, you can spend more time with your patients. And what happened during COVID, when effectively we were in a fully funded, capitated model, not predicated on doing little bits of work for little fees, which is high volume, low margin, dentists and teams liked it. We could spend time with their patients. And that's where we need to get back to. Patients deserve to have time spent with them. And as Atif said, you're in disease management process, but we can't actually manage disease. We're treating disease. We need to invest in prevention. And that doesn't need to be done specifically by a dentist. It needs to be done by the dental team. We have a whole team that can deliver this. But we need to get the government to buy into prevention.
Okay, let me come back to you on one small point and then take us on to prevention, because you didn't mention training at all. Are there sufficient training places in Scotland, but the destination of the trainees is the private sector rather than the NHS?
There's no point training more dentists that don't want to work in the NHS.
Sure, I just needed to understand that so that we're clear about that. So let me go on to the model that is currently in place with the SDR for treatments and materials. That clearly, you seem to be suggesting, disincentivises people into NHS dentistry, because as both Douglas and yourself have described, you know, just the sheer kind of pace of payment is not matched by the activity. How would you change that to a prevention model?
My view is we need to have a fully capitated model along the lines of general medical practice for us to deploy our teams. Because at the minute, the only person that can produce any funding for the practice is the dentist. So the dentist has to be on the treadmill, as Douglas says. That is not the way to run any clinic. In 2023, we need to move on from that. High volume, low margin healthcare does not work.
Anybody got a view to add to that?
Yes. So, Jack, I would say, I think it's very, very important if collectively we can get this one point across to you, is that, you know, we all care about the NHS dental service. We all believe in it, and we all want it to thrive. You know, but the thing is that, and we have worked for many, many years in trying to make this work, but increasingly, as David is saying, is that younger dentists see the flaws in the system, because it's a low-fee, high-volume, disease-centred model. I have to keep coming back to this word, it's a disease-centred model. We're not trying to prevent things. So we need to move to a more modern approach. The modern approach is a preventative model. So we're preventing disease. So instead of measuring, saying how many treatments are dentists doing, how many treatments are doing, where is their activity? If you're doing treatment activity, that's not good. That's not good. Right? We should actually be measuring the reverse. Right? So we for some reason are wedded to this delivery model in Scotland, and I don't know. I do know why. It was ahead of its time. So the NHS, we were brave when we created the NHS, right? It was something that no other part of the world had. But unfortunately, within dentistry, we've delivered the same model for over 70 years. And that model is closer to being an antique than it is to being modern. And because it's closer to being an antique, you can't blame the younger dentists for not wanting to go into it, because actually it scares them. Because they think, I'm going to have to go into NHS dentistry and I have to do this high volume dentistry, which goes against everything that they're taught at university. Right? So actually scares them. So the reason that they don't go into it, it's not about the money. It's about the actual type of delivery that they're doing. So they step away from it. Do you know? So what we absolutely need to do is we need to change that, flip that. As Professor Conway was saying, actually, in last week's meeting, where he said that they spent, the Child Smile Programme, brilliant, right? I mean, we should be very, very proud of that. They spent £2 million on prevention and they had £5 million of treatment savings. So that's our model moving forward.
Thank you very much for that. Other people will ask you about Child Smile, but I share your view of it. Can I take us on to dental corporates operating in the UK and now indeed some of them operating in Scotland? What impact do you think this has on NHS dental services? I don't know who wants that one.
So many corporates are coming into the market, increasingly so. The good or bad, I'm not sure, remains to be seen. Many practice owners, because of the challenges of trying to deliver the service, the NHS dental service, they are selling their practices. And these practices are being bought in the main by corporates. But here's the problem. The thing is that the corporate then doesn't have the ability, so they buy the practice or they take over the practice, but there's a shortage of dentists. So the delivery isn't there. So that's not a good thing. Do I think that, in my personal view, do I think that it would be good for Scotland to have corporate dentistry delivering the service? No. I think that it's much better to have individually owned practices that are headed up by a principal dentist that is controlling the delivery. I think people will get a better, much, much better level of service. But that's what is happening. I mean, we have communicated this to the Chief Dental Officer, that there's a trend towards corporates taking over dental practices in Scotland. We don't think that's good. But if we want to change the tide, we need to make some big reform.
Okay. Big reform. I literally have seconds in which to finish up my session with you. I wonder if Douglas or David have anything to add. And can I throw in one final question to the mix, because the convener won't let me back in. Do you think the government should collect and publish the NHS commitment of each dentist or each practice so that we get a more realistic picture of GDS coverage in Scotland? Douglas.
On that front, I'm not entirely sure, because there's a bit of a danger that becomes a witch hunt for dentists who are doing more private work than NHS work. Not that I've got anything to fear on that front whatsoever. In terms of the corporates, the big difference is they're a business. They'll fulfil their contractual obligation to the letter, I'm sure, but spiritually there's nothing more. I mean, we've already seen Bupa offload practices that don't make them any money. Corporates are there to make money. We're there to provide an NHS service. Ultimately, it's all going to end up corporate, because independent people like me simply can't afford to bankroll a very non-profitable business over the short and medium term, waiting for reform to come at the other end. The corporates can afford to buy the practices, fund the short-term shortfalls, and if the NHS system's good, they've won. If the NHS system's bad, they go private and they've still won. But the kind of owner-operators like myself, I think, stand to lose all round, short of selling to corporates, which isn't necessarily what we want to do for ourselves, our staff or our patients.
Thank you. David?
Just on NHS commitment, Jackie, it depends how you measure NHS commitment. Currently, NHS commitment is measured on a financial model. So, for example, if someone does an implant within a practice and that implant might cost £2,000, you'll have to do hundreds of checkups to get the same measurement. That's what you would need to do, hundreds of NHS checkups. So be careful with the measurement for NHS commitment.
Okay. Thank the three of you very much.
Thank you, Jackie. Brian, I'll move on to you just now. And we are looking at Theme two.
Thank you. Good morning, gentlemen. I think, funny enough, the theme that I was going to go on, you've answered quite a lot of the issues that I was going to raise. So I think some of the things that really are worrying, I think, especially in the preventative side of things, is potentially, we heard last week about the inequality within the service around, you know, the more affluent areas versus, you know, those in SIMD 1 and 2. Can you tell us perhaps during COVID your experiences in that arena, and why does there seem to be such a disparity, an increasing disparity between the two?
So, I mean, patients who've had the most experience of dental disease over their lives need the most maintenance and the most encouragement to maintain their oral health, and COVID certainly cause them to suffer the most. But I can think of plenty of examples within our practice of patients whose mouths have deteriorated terribly over the last 3 years in a way that over the previous 20 years they just hadn't. There also is a situation where they also required more complex treatments, the root treatments, crowns, dentures, provided in the NHS, which currently are the least profitable, in fact, most loss-making items of treatment to do, and also the most time-consuming. So these people are losing out, and the dentists that treat them are finding it increasingly hard to find a way to make things work for them. In a more affluent area where, for example, the enhanced exam fee allows people to be seen, practices to make a greater profit from seeing these people on a regular basis, things are quite nice. If you see a patient who needs nothing done and it's just a case of an exam, see you in 6 months, and you can do that all day long, it works really nicely. Whereas we do an exam, see you in 6 months to continue the course of treatment, and we still haven't been paid for the exam. That's where the patients in more deprived areas tend to suffer more.
Does any other general want to come in on that?
What I would say to this is look, I come back to the same point, and I'm sorry if I keep going over this again and again, but I just care about the people of Scotland. The thing is, we are failing them, right? We are failing them with this, but because if they need treatment, we are failing them, right? And this is why they have a bad feeling. They don't have a good feeling. The people of Scotland don't have a good feeling about going to the dentist. And that's, again, down to the delivery model, right? So because every time they go, they get treatment. So, and if you live in a deprived area, you're going to get more severe treatment, which is not going to actually make it easy for you to go psychologically. Do you know? So what we need to do is we need to absolutely change the focus of what we are doing. Do you know? Because we are failing the Scottish people.
Yes, David.
What I would say is back to what I said before, the current system of delivery does not allow us the skill mix within the practice. So within my practice, we've got 12,500 patients registered with a high level of children. We've probably got over 3,000 children registered. The SDR at the minute doesn't allow me to get group sessions in for child smile delivery, and that's what I would like to do. There's no one knows better than my practice what our patients need. Scottish Government don't know, the civil service team don't know. We need autonomy to deliver that service, and we can't do that under high volume, low margin. You know, we have therapists that can deliver it, hygienists that can deliver it, trained child smile nurses that can deliver it, and we also have oral health educators that can deliver it. And we can work in partnership with Child Smile Nursery, Child Smile School, to deliver that. But the NHS system we have right now doesn't allow us to do that. That's what we need. But as I said, we need root and branch reform to make that work.
So I guess then, you know, just to clarify, the outcome of that is increased number to children needing referred to secondary care for extractions and the likes, which is obviously more time-consuming, more costly, and just back on the treadmill. I think that's the word that's going to stick with me in this session. So basically, I guess what this committee is called COVID recovery. You're painting a realistic, if reasonably bleak, picture here of Scottish dentistry. So we're not going to get. You've said, David, we're not going to get out of this under the current system. The bylaw is not going to be dealt with under the current system. So can I ask probably again, from my own personal understanding, where do we need to go? What needs to happen to get out of this, to get us back onto a reasonable path? Dr. Bashir, if you want to, Dr. David, sorry.
We need to make the NHS more attractive, Brian. It's as simple as that. We need to encourage younger people.
How do we do it?
We need to get away from a treadmill effect. Low volume, high margin. Low volume, high margin does not work. So younger dentists coming in, they don't want to see 40 patients a day.
Is it not high volume, low margin?
High volume, low margin.
I'm confused. Yeah. I'm really easily confused.
I say it all the time. We need to get away from that. So we need to make it more attractive. Somebody coming into an NHS practice does not want to be seeing 40 patients a day. You don't want to be seeing that. We don't need to see 40 patients a day. We can recruit other members of the team that doesn't have to be a dentist to deliver that. Unfortunately, in my practice, I've lost two therapists because the therapists do not want to work in the NHS practice. Now, for me to do that, you're actually paying them at cost because we need to deliver it. What I will say, Brian, is where I work in Gavan Hill in Glasgow is the former First Minister's constituency. And because of the cohort of patients we have, we are probably the highest referrer for paediatric GA in Scotland because of where we are. So what's really frustrating for me is the current waiting list. So we get a four-year-old that comes in, eight decayed teeth, don't speak English as a first language, and we have to refer through a clunky Sky Gateway system that takes time, for which there is no remuneration at all. And the current waiting list is something like 96 weeks to get that seen. It's outrageous. This is not a new problem. This has been going on for more than a decade, and we need ministerial government intervention to do something about it.
What you're describing there really is a system that you say that needs turned around, but it seems to me it's a bit of a tanker. Trying to turn a tanker, it's going to take time and planning to be able to deliver, because you can't all of a sudden make it attractive for new dentists into NHS dentistry. It's going to take a lot of time.
It needs radical change. No, not just tinkering about with items in an SDR. And these radical change.
If I could just add on the referrals for the children's extractions. I mean, in less extreme cases where children need some teeth out at the age of kind of 4, 5, 6, it is quite doable in general practice to the right dentist with the right mindset, given enough time. But it's so unattractive to anyone to want to do that for the fee they get. Because I mean, if you've got an anxious parent, an anxious child, an anxious nurse, four patients complaining in the waiting room, you're running late. No one wants to do it. If we were paid in a way that made doing that in general practice doable, people would do it. I mean, we've got some associates in our practice that have started doing that and gradually realised it's just too much for them. And again, it comes back to whether it's a capitation-based payment model, something that allows dentists time to do what they're good at rather than being forced to do items of service just to generate enough money to stay open. And again, children's dentistry at that basic level should be a basic skill that we're all good at and proud to do, but it's not something that carries much kudos in the profession anymore, which is a shame.
So I'd just like to add, I mean, just to give you some kind of practical things that we can do in the here and the now, is that one thing that we could do is we could take the current item of service model and we can, you know, take out the things that aren't needed to secure oral health. That would then make working within the NHS dentistry a little bit more attractive.
Not to take the things out that don't.
Yeah, so just now we need to go back and say, okay, what is it that we want to deliver on the NHS for the people of Scotland? You know, the government. What does the government want to deliver? Do we want to deliver a service that secures oral health, or do we want to deliver a world-class dental service to the Scottish people, right? That includes everything, right? So everything that the dental need that patient might have is met on the NHS. Now, currently, that doesn't happen anyway, right? And that's one of the reasons why patients have to, in my view, wrongly, so step out of the NHS and access private care, because that item that they want is not available on the NHS. So actually, currently, the system is deficient. So it's deficient. So we're not I'm saying, okay, let's reduce it, right, to a system that secures oral health in the first instance, using the same budget that we have, right, use any surplus income to push that into our prevention. So that's one thing that we can do. The second thing that we could do, and this would make it more attractive for dentists, right, into the NHS. So the second thing that we could do is that we could change the contract. So the contract is between the health board and the dentist, and we can shift that from the health board to the practice owner. Because one of the issues that we have is that I can't get the associate in my practice to do more NHS work than they, he or she may want to. So we want them to do more. It's up to them whether they do more or they don't do more. If they want to do more private, so we lose this control. You lose this control. So that's a second thing that you could do. So that's two very simple things that the Scottish Government could do to make the delivery more accessible and make the model a little bit more attractive for new dentists coming into the system.
So many, I don't know, so many questions, but, you know.
Yep, okay. John, could you go to...
Yep, thank you. I mean, I think we're all on the same theme now about reform, so stick to that. I mean, I like the bullet points you had, Dr. Bashir. I like bullet points. So you certainly covered a lot of ground. And one of them, right towards the end, is we are not asking for extra money. But, I mean, all I'm hearing so far is this is going to cost a lot of money. Because if you go from seeing 40 patients a day to 10, you need presumably four times as many dentists or other staff. So there's got to be a big increase in money, has there not?
Yes, if you maintain the same items of service. You know, so we work off a menu. This is a big menu. We have all these items of service that we can provide. But what I'm saying is, look, we don't need, you know...
From the government's point of view, the government's writing a cheque, and at the moment it's items.
So
if it changes, is the government going to have to write a bigger cheque?
No, right? Not in the short term. So the thing is that you can renew... We need to make the system more effective for the Scottish people and more attractive. So there's two things we need to do. Make it more effective for the Scottish people and make it more attractive for dentists to work in so we can retain them on the NHS. Right? So I hope we all agree that this system... Is there anybody in the room? Can I ask, is there anybody in the room that actually agrees? So I'm going to put the question to you. Is there anybody in the room that actually agrees that we should be delivering a high-volume, disease-centred model to the Scottish people?
Well, I think the answer to that is, I'm also speaking to GPs. You've said you'd like a system like the GPs, but the GPs are totally unhappy as well.
Yeah, sometimes
people... They can't recruit GPs.
Yes.
People stay in the hospitals. They can't recruit staff. They can't get locums, etc., etc., etc. So there's a huge amount wrong with the GP system.
Yes.
Now, one suggestion is let's employ all the GPs by the health board. So that would be another possibility. Yes. Let's have the health board employ all the dentists. Would that work?
Yes. I think anything is better, right, than this model, because we've been utilising this model for 70 years. And look, I want to see a Scottish population that is the healthiest, the smiliest in Europe. That's what I want to see, right? So the thing is that now that's my vision, and I think that should be our vision. That should be our vision. So we're saying, and I think David and the BDA and the SDA have probably communicated to the government that our proposal was to go to a more affordable, so take the items of service.
Well, I do want to let the others in as well, because
you've said
quite a lot.
So,
Mr. McCall, are you speaking to the government? What are the government saying?
Yes, we are speaking to the government about a blended model of delivery. So where we are at the minute is that NHS practice is unsustainable under the current model. I think it does need more money in it. But what I will tell you is that currently the NHS budget in Scotland is £19 billion. 6 years ago, it was 12. Now, that proportionately has not gone into primary care, and that's the problem. So that's why you're having a problem with the GPs. They can't recruit, because they can't see a future down the line here. So primary care has always been a subset of healthcare. All of that funding has gone into secondary care. We need to address that.
Mr. Tain, I mean, I don't know if you're aware of what's happening in other countries, because one of the suggestions is we should have a world-class health service. Where is the world-class dental service?
It's certainly not here. I mean, just on your point about employment, I mean, maybe employing dentists, the country would then discover the true cost of what the dental budget should be to offer a salary of a level that would attract people to be employed NHS dentists and find the sheer number of people it would take to work at a pace that employees could work with without ending up resigning, going off sick, etc. Again, there are lots of other countries that have different models.
Private?
I think it's a combination of state-funded and private-funded.
Do we know, are there any countries with a completely state-funded system and no private, or very little private?
Not to my knowledge.
No.
But again, we've got a state-funded system which funds a comprehensive care, which looked reasonable in 1990, probably the most recent. It's a comprehensive but outdated SDR. The kind of best items of service we can provide aren't on the SDR and simply never will be in the SDR, both in terms of restorative dentistry, implants, preventive dentistry, children's care. None of that is really done to kind of what's considered international best practice. Periodontal disease is another area where the NHS item of service is just a mile from where it should be. We've got a kind of McDonald's budget and we're trying to provide some kind of sit-down meal on that. It's just not working.
And is the government listening to you?
You are only to the BDA or what?
No one listens to me.
Well, we're listening.
Yeah, but I think that's, it's a thing, we're our own worst enemies in some ways. We'd made it work as far as we could up until, 2019, 2020. And now, I think the same thing, the goodwill of the profession has been lost in a lot of ways. People have lost faith that meaningful reform is going to come, that we can do the best for our patients. Patients are turning against practices, and I think that's probably safe to say that in dentistry as well as healthcare. Generally, we get the blame for not seeing patients. We've had letters from people who are not patients making formal complaints that we haven't seen them yet. I mean, it's like a new level of complaint we have to contend with.
I mean, last week, I can't remember exactly who we had last week, but we had kind of academic people and things like that. But when I suggested, well, we could move to quite a radical change, maybe like GP practices, they just said, oh, that's too big a jump. Well, is there any sense from the government?
I know when we'd spoken to the chief dental officer about that in the past, he said the problem was they wouldn't know how to measure health outcomes in dentistry, whereas we can measure input, and that's been the barrier to it. They can see exactly what they do. So there must be ways to measure the output. I mean, trust us for a few years, measure people's oral health, see that what we've been doing has made things better, not worse.
How do we measure their output? I mean, is it not just the same problem?
Yeah. They seem to be trusted to do what they think's best.
Okay, so do you want back in, Mr. Basher?
No, I'll let David come in.
Oh, sorry, David.
I was just going to say that we actually had that system during COVID. It was along the lines of general medical practice. The civil service team didn't measure it properly, and they weren't proportionate in the response for the practices. You weren't doing enough. 10% of any profession are aberrant. They sit out there, and they don't play the game. You can't do anything about that. Same as politics. Maybe slightly higher in politics than 10%, but that's just the way it is. So there is a measure you can there. So what happens if you have a fully capitated system that's weighted? Then if practices don't want to treat patients and will just sit there and take funding and do nothing, they will not last because patients are not daft. They will go to another practice that will deliver the care. So the self-levelling will happen. Trust us for a few years and it will level out and it will allow us to deliver the care to the cohort of patients that we have. Because you can't have a panacea all across Scotland. As Brian has said, you've got areas of deprivation 1, 2, and you get deprivation 5. And it's not the same delivery model you need for everything.
And during COVID, do you know
how much extra it costs the government to put money into the dental service?
It depends how the government costs it. What they will is they'll try and pretend they spent a lot of money on PPE, and that went into dentistry. So they say they spent 150 million in addition. The problem was that they had to cover the patient charge revenue, which is about £75 million a year. So that quirk in dentistry is if you come in and get some dental treatment and you have to pay for it, you have to pay 80% of that cost. So what happened during COVID was that patient charge revenue of £75 million wasn't there. And in order to sustain NHS practices, the government needed to fund that.
So you got extra money and you didn't see me because I haven't been to the dentist for 3 years.
Well, I didn't see you because I was busy seeing other people.
Right, I'll leave it at that.
Okay, thank you, John. Stuart.
Okay, thank you. There's a few things have been said already this morning. Profit, loss-making, it's a business, but care about people. It's not a new problem. It's been a problem for the last decade. Need to make it more attractive. So just a few questions around this, just in terms of making it attractive. So first of all, what is the average salary for an NHS dentist in comparison to a dentist who does private work?
I don't have those figures. But what I can tell you is that the average associate in Scotland earnings are less than the average associate in England. So it's not an attractive place to work. We also have higher tax in Scotland, as you know. So even trying to recruit people from England, we can't do it.
I must admit, I don't do enough private work to have a baseline there, and I don't speak to enough dentists or fully drive it to have much of an opinion on what they make. But
I don't think so much the revenue and the salary. I think it's more terms and conditions. And I think it's more what people are trained to do. We're in an area now where people want the teeth widened, they want composite bonding, they want the teeth straightened. This is where we are. When I met with your First Minister, when he was Health Minister, when they brought in free treatment for under 26-year-olds, I said, the communication here has got to be key, because I don't want to have that argument with a patient coming in who wants straight white teeth under the NHS. And that's what we'll get for under 26-year-olds. So it's about conditions. That's where we are. We have to accept we're in this mixed market economy of what the NHS can deliver and what private treatment can deliver. And we've got to accept that, embrace it, and realise it's going to be deliverable through NHS practices. That's the only way forward. Because we can't have a two-tier system out there where you have a fully private practice and a fully NHS practice. We need to accept that that economy is there.
I mean, I asked that particular question just because of the submissions that we have received. Now, John Mason just touched upon something a moment ago. So from Dr. Bashir's statement of one of the bullet points was, we're not asking for extra money. And certainly, Mr. McCall, your statement, and I quote, and it was paragraph 3 from that, and it's with a contract that's unfit for purpose, underfunded, overstretched, and facing the challenge of deep and widening oral health inequalities. And also, just in terms of the another bullet point from the Scottish dental practice owners, they're also business owners and entrepreneurs who invest in Scottish public health. So certainly, what I've heard today, and in terms of reading the paperwork, I do not doubt at all the three of you, and also the people that you represent, the colleagues that you represent, in terms of wanting to do the best for your patients. I don't think anyone would doubt that at all. But certainly much of what I have heard, and the focus has been about money. And
can I come in?
Sure. Sure.
I think, you know, we need to be realistic, right? So we are in a situation with the pandemic and COVID, etc., something that the world hadn't seen in recent years. It's how do we come out of that? Because this is how are we going to, so what steps, right? We don't want to ask you to be able to take a step that you can't take, right? So it needs to be like small steps, right? So if we only have a limited budget, I mean, I don't know what budget you have. That's, you have the budget, or the government has the budget. Do you know, the thing is that if we only have that budget, then we have to find a better way of spending that, right? Do you know, it's public money, right? Do you know, so the thing is that we have to speak up. We have to tell you, the people that are running the country, actually, this, as the providers at the front line, saying that this is not good enough. It's not serving the people of Scotland well enough, right? Now, the thing is that, okay, if that's our only budget, then let's use that budget better, right? Better means let's trim down the items of service that we have on the NHS, but we don't go below this securing people's oral health, right? So that's our line, right? So that's our marker, and be any additional funds that we have left, we put that into prevention, right? So that's a way forward, right? It's a step forward, right? It should be much more than that, but I think that's the first step. So that's why, that's the backdrop, the narrative behind that statement.
So, let me say something has popped into my head that I'd really like to ask. Okay. I will come back to you. Right. Dr. Bashir, are you saying that there is too much choice on the NHS for the type of treatment and the fund that you have available?
No, there's too much choice. I'll let David answer that.
Currently within our SDR, we have 600 items of treatment that have been there since before 1990, and none of them make any sense anymore. We don't even understand half of those items, and we've been working in the NHS probably for about 100 years between us, and we don't understand it. It needed to be reformed a long time ago. So what they're currently trying to do is to try and whittle those down to a few items that's workable under an SDR. But I think, as we've all agreed, none of us want to go back to an SDR. We need to go to a funding model that allows us to deliver what we can to our patients.
Thanks for that clarification. Stuart, my apologies.
Thank you. All right, so Dr. Bashir, in terms of that narrative that you just told this committee, is that the narrative that's actually been put forward to the Scottish Government and officials within the Scottish Government? Because it certainly sounded very clear and kind of a logical step forward. But that's not what's came across.
Thank you, Stuart, for the question. You know, we are desperate. The Scottish Dental Practice Owners Group are desperate to sit down with the policymakers, but who are currently been reviewing this NHS delivery model. But we are currently being excluded, and have been told that they are already aware of the Scottish Dental Practice Owners' opinions. But I'm here to tell you that they're not, because no one has asked us. You know, so the last statement on our submission was just simply this: listen to the profession. You know, and I suppose David might be able to give you more of an insight, because they have been in negotiations or talks with the government, and David, would you like to give your feedback to the committee?
Yeah, obviously, Stuart, I can't say anything specific about our negotiations because they're currently private and confidential, but our preferred model is not to go back to the SDR, and we can't repeat that often enough. We need to go to a weighted capitated model. We're quite happy to talk to the Scottish Government about that, but I think they have stated that they're preferred method of delivery is a blended model of capitation, continuing care, alliances and item of service. So yes, so government will say, we hear you, but we need them to listen.
Yeah. Okay.
And we need them to engage, Stuart, with the three organisations. With the three organisations.
Okay. We've got a few other questions. Just in terms of the survey that was undertaken, so why did 30% of dentists, according to your survey, and 31% of the respondents to the committee survey, not apply for the additional funding throughout COVID?
If I can answer that briefly, it's on my own behalf. We'd applied for ventilation funding for our practice and were refused by our health board to have ventilation installed, because the standard ventilation, which was proposed by one of the contractors who's done a lot of practices, didn't meet the standards they thought was appropriate for our building. They had several other contractors put forward proposals. Nothing was done. There was seemingly a ventilation action group formed in Lanarkshire to look at how they could install ventilation. Nothing happened with it, and that has now disappeared in the rearview mirror. And we lost the patient access relative to other practices for the period from when we first applied until ventilation wasn't an issue. I assume other practices might be in similar situations. Maybe some people with ventilation installed in the first place. But I do think there are questions over the science as to how appropriate the ventilation recommended and installed in a lot of places actually was. Certainly, Lanarkshire Health Board questioned the government's science on that front.
Okay. Mr. McCall?
Stuart, the ventilation was a complicated issue. It's not just a matter of putting in a fan one bit and sticking a fan out the other bit. So if you look at that funding equated to £5,000 per practice. My practice is in a health centre, which is owned by Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board. We, at that time, we had three surgeries there. We now have five. And so I got the Estates Department and the board to give me a quote for the ventilation system. Ventilation system for the three surgeries is going to be £50,000. So £5,000 didn't even touch it. It wasn't even here. It needed to be more specific about what the requirements would be, because, as I said, you can't just draw in from air in from somewhere and put it out somewhere else. There needs to be HEPA filters involved. So what I ended up doing was I ended up just buying 2 HEPA filters per surgery, which got me up to the requirement of 10 air changes per hour. But this is going to be an ongoing problem, not just within dental surgeries, but I think within the whole of the NHS.
Throughout the recent times, the Oral Health Improvement Group had a suggestion to bring in directors of dentistry in each health board area, and that has since happened. Has that been beneficial?
It's been beneficial because I do have a working relationship with the Director of Dentistry in Glasgow and Clyde. But sometimes I feel he's hamstrung with the board because the board is very, very heavily centric on secondary care. And I've said for many, many years, what we actually need at board level is a primary care board to integrate with that. It goes back to the funding for everything going into secondary care and primary care just being left behind.
Okay.
Personally, I can't see any significant benefit, although it's been such an unusual time, that's maybe an unfair comment.
Okay. In terms of graduates, how are graduates incentivised to actually work in the NHS?
Are they
incentivised?
I think, as David's already said, that there isn't much of an incentive for them to go into NHS dentistry, so this is the... It's becoming more and more unattractive for them. And that's, again, relating to the delivery model. You know, so we need to shift, we need that shift to happen. It needs to be a preventive-based model as opposed to a disease-centred model. So there is no real incentive for them to go into the NHS.
Mr. McCall.
The government have incentives in forms of... golden handcuffs, golden handshakes, bursaries, they don't work. That's a very short-term fix. You know, short-term fixes do not work. We need to make the NHS a long-term attractive place to work where people can go and have a career. And currently, if they go and work in a practice and they're possibly two dentists working in the practice and the most qualified person is 2 years, there's no managed clinical network there. There's no training. There's no support. That's why they don't want to go in there. We need to have a practice model will we have that managed clinical network and support.
Mr. Steyn?
As a vocational trainer for 10 years, when I'd have a new graduate in my practice for 10 years, it was quite a soul-destroying experience having to unteach them the best practice they'd spent their university career learning to teach them a way that things can be made to work in the NHS. And you know, I think even just that initial exposure makes a lot of people realise that the next career move it's going to be very briefly NHS, if at all. I mean, we used to have associates who stay with us for a good few years after doing their vocational training years, how we developed our business. But now, that just doesn't happen to the same extent. They know there's a better life out there. They know there's a better way to do the right thing for their patients out there. And they're not willing to sacrifice themselves for the NHS the way I think we all did without considering a sacrifice at the time.
Okay. And my final question, just in terms of the dealing with the pandemic, what funding or other measures would have actually increased the capacity and the recovery for practices? Mr. McCall?
Sure, I'm going to come back to that any recovery hinges in reform. And I think we've said that, I don't know how many times in this session today. You know, we really need radical reform because tinkering about and rearranging the deck chairs in the Titanic is just not going to work this time. You know, we need a radical rethink about how we deliver NHS dentistry. And we all want NHS dentistry to work. We have the goodwill in NHS dentistry between us. We want to make sure that NHS survives and the patients get the treatment that they need. We don't want to go back to people queuing around the street for registering, and that's not what we want to see. We need it to work.
Very close to finishing up.
So briefly.
Yep. I'm just. Well.
Yeah, I was going to say. I mean, in terms of how things could have been improved, I think, early 2021, we'd organised an online conference at which the Chief Dental Officer spoke, and there was a commitment to the SDR not returning, a commitment to engaging with profession to get reform. And I think at that stage, there was actually enthusiasm amongst the profession to engage in creating something better so that once everything had ground to halt during COVID, it literally was a once-in-a-career chance to start again doing something different. And there was definitely goodwill there, people wanting to make that work. I think, and as time's gone by and people have seen that not happen, that's where a lot of practices and a lot of individual dentists have started to move away from providing NHS dentistry to private. And yeah, I mean, the train's left the station now, so many people have just lost faith. You know, the gesture it's going to take to get things back on track has to be bigger now than it would have been 2 years ago or a year ago.
Thank you.
Yep.
One final thing I would add is that I would ask you to use dentists on the NHS better. So use them better. So you're using them as tooth mechanics, really?
One final, very final, I'm sorry, we're already 10 minutes over time, but I've got one very final thing I want to ask you, because there's an anomaly in some of the things that I'm hearing, in the sense that you're saying we need to get a system of prevention rather than cure, and yet we've got this backlog of people with diseased teeth. So what does it take to bring those two things together in order to get a, and I know, David, you're going to say it's going to take reform, but what does that look like?
If we have reform, we can then attract more people into our practice and our practice team to deliver it. But without that, we can't attract anyone in at the minute.
But if we have a fixed budget right now, and I promise you this is not a gotcha question, I'm merely trying to get my head around this. We have a fixed budget. You have this backlog of people with diseased teeth that need to be sorted, but we also have the requirement to create a system of prevention. How do you do that? Can you physically do that?
What we need to do is be realistic about what we're delivering at the minute. And the reason why we're delivering the type of care we're doing is because of the SDR. That's why we need to get rid of that SDR.
Hey, David, Douglas, sorry.
I mean, that is the impossible conundrum. I think the truth is the only way to move forward is to have probably two separate trains of thought there. The preventive side needs to be brought forward so that children growing up don't have significant dental disease.
Well, it was all about.
It was. I mean, is this something that needs to be done more of and taken more through adulthood? I mean, the child smell worked, but so long as we focus too heavily on catching up with the backlog, then that the preventive end is never going to become big enough to take over. I mean, that is the problem. In an ideal world, we need twice as many dentists for a couple of years, all been paid enough to make them want to do the job, and then we can get rid of half of them that we don't need. That's okay. Pie in the sky.
Atif, you got the last word on this.
What to do next? Reduce the SDR, the 600 items, as David's already mentioned, reduce them to only items that will secure oral health. Right, that's our first base, right? We've got to get to that. That's our first base. Remunerate the people that are the providers better for what they're doing, within the same budget, start to promote our preventive model. If we do this, we'll make the NHS more attractive for dentists to work in, and that's what we want.
Okay, gentlemen, thank you very much for your time this morning. We have gone quite a bit over the time, so thank you very much for that extra time. If there's any other evidence you'd like to raise with the committee, you can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you to do that. We'll be hearing from the Scottish Government at our next meeting on the 29th of June, which will conclude our evidence-taking on this inquiry. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, so I suspend the meeting to allow our witnesses to leave, and we will move into private. Gentlemen, thank you very much.